Welcome to the Oasis. My name is Mike, and today we're going to be talking to Jan from the Beat Saber team in this developer interview. For those that have been living under a rock and have no idea what I'm talking about, Beat Saber is a virtual reality beat rhythm game where you have to slash blue and red cubes in time with the music. It's incredibly well done game. Like, it's done really well since its launch on the 1st of May and is currently available on Steam and Oculus Home if you're interested to check it out yourself. So let me introduce you to my guest on the show. Welcome to Jan. How are you doing today, Jan? Nice to meet you.
Yeah. Nice to meet you too. I'm great.
Thanks. Yeah, very, very well. I was just admiring your background there. You know, are you at home now, or are you in the studio?
I'm at home. I work from home, so I'm home all the time.
Nice, nice. I can relate to that. But you've got this really cool background there. It looks very space age. I really like it. It looks really cool.
Yeah, I need a lot of space to test the games, you know.
Of course. So thanks for being on the show. I really appreciate you taking time to do this. Obviously, we're here to talk about Beat Saber and the studio Hyperbolic Magnetism. But first off, let's get to know you a little bit more, Jan, and find out a little bit more about you. So how did you end up developing games for a living? Like, what's your sort of history? What's your background?
Actually, we started making games maybe when we were 10.
Wow.
With my friend. Yeah, it's a really long time ago, but we never published anything because it was much harder back then, like now.
Yeah.
But when we went out from university, we actually, me and my colleague, we studied computer science, computer graphics programming. So it was a natural decision to maybe start working on something which is connected to graphics, and games are really something we always wanted to do.
Yeah.
So we started making small games on iOS because it was super easy just to publish anything on iPhone. And we heard a lot of stories about instant success and all that stuff. So it was very tempting to work there. So I made a small app. It was called Midnight.
Okay.
It was just some kind of particle simulator, and it sold more than 50,000 copies, and I made it just in 1 week. So I was like, okay, this is a real business. we can live just by doing this stuff. But then we made a game which took 3 years to finish.
Oh, wow.
And it was a huge fail.
Oh.
So yeah. So this happens. So we were more like, this was like downside of the development. And then we made more the games. And I think 2 years ago, we released a game called Chameleon Run.
Of course.
Which went really, really well. We sold a lot of copies and won Apple Design Award, which gave us a lot of space to experiment on new stuff. So when I get HTC Vive, I just wanted to experiment, play some games, and the idea of the Beat Saber came to my mind.
Amazing. Amazing. So you're currently based in Prague in the Czech Republic, right?
Yes.
Have you always been based there? Have you always lived there?
No, actually, both of us from Hyperbolic Magnetism, we are from Slovakia.
Right.
And we lived there till we were 18.
Yeah.
Then we moved to Prague. So Prague. So we are here for, I don't know, it's more than 10 years now, or wow, maybe 15 years in Prague. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And the other guy, this mysterious character, it's Vladimir, right? Loki.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so you two guys met at school, and then you started developing, making games together, but you never released anything. And then you moved on to iOS when, you know, iOS platform came out. So I'm intrigued to know, you said you had some success on your first one, Midnight, but then you worked on a game for, you'd say, 3 years solidly, and it was a failure. What game was that?
It's called Looms.
Right.
Like the same name as Rayman Looms.
Right.
Yeah, it was game. You can check it out. It's something which looks a little bit like Angry Birds, but in the core, it's a very different game. And that's maybe the problem that many people thought that, okay, they just made another Angry Birds clone or something like that.
Right.
But actually, it's a very different game. Just the basic physics are maybe the same.
Right. But like, obviously, you know, although you say that the game was a failure in your eyes, like you still had the determination to bounce back and keep making games. Like it didn't stop you at all. It didn't stop you from, you know, wanting to carry on as a game developer.
Yeah, sure. Right now we know we want to make games forever or
Of course.
forever. Yeah. So nothing like this can stop us. Maybe if we don't have any money, then maybe if we don't have anything to eat, then maybe we will do something else. But till then, we are working on games.
So let's talk about hyperbolic magnetism, because that's the studio name that created Beat Saber, right? And you say that that was created with you and Vladimir, like Lurkaman. So is it just the two of you that created hyperbolic magnetism?
Actually, we both are created hyperbolic magnetism, but right now the Beat Saber will be published or developed further in a company named Beat Games.
Beat
So
games.
hyperbolic magnetism will change to Beat Games because the our music guy Yaroslav, who did the whole soundtrack, he was so excited about the whole project that he basically joined the company. So right now we are it's three of us in the company, so it's changing a little bit.
So hyperbolic magnetism is you and Vladimir, and then you've got Beat Games, which is you, Vladimir, and Yaroslav. Is that right?
Yes, exactly like that.
Okay, I get that. I get that. So, just going back a couple of steps. So, you said you were developing games for iOS, and you made quite a few games for iOS, didn't you? Like, I know Chameleon Run was a successful one, like you say. You won a lot of awards for that game. It did very well. But what was the sort of challenges you faced from moving from iOS game development to developing a game for VR?
There were a few challenges. The first one is quite obvious. It's very uncomfortable to develop anything for VR because all you have to put the headset all the time on your head, test it, and put it back, do some programming, and so this is which was really different, and also showcasing the game is super different.
Yes, of course.
Because if you are doing mobile, you just show people that, okay, this is our game. And if you want to showcase the VR game, you have to bring a lot of stuff, a high-end computer, maybe a green screen for mixed reality setup. So this was a huge change for us, but it was fun. It was a lot of fun.
So you say you picked up a HTC Vive. Was that one of the sort of early days when the HTC Vive just came out, and then you were just sort of playing around with it, or?
I think it was quite, yeah. I think I bought it instantly when it came out in here. I think I was waiting for it for 4 months or something like that, because it was always like, yeah, it should be here next week, next week, next week, and 4 months passed by, and I still didn't have it. But then it came, and I started working on it.
And then as soon as you sort of started experience VR for yourself, you knew in your mind, I need to start making a game for virtual reality.
Not instantly, actually. I feel like, okay, this is the beginning of VR. We are still it's not there yet, but it's almost there. So it works. But I wanted to try some games, so I played Audio Shield, of course.
Of course.
Yeah, and I'm a musician, so I was really looking forward to play it. But I was a little bit disappointed, not because of the game itself, but about the decision to generate the levels from the music procedurally, because sometimes it didn't fit the music perfectly. Sometimes it was good, sometimes it wasn't. So the experience was a little bit like okay, somewhere in the middle. And I was thinking, okay, let's maybe try to make it a little bit different. Let's try to make it by hand, so you feel each note that it fits perfectly in the music. So this was the starting point for the production of the Beat Saber.
Excellent. So that's how the sort of game came to be. Was Beat Saber the first idea you had for a VR game, or did you have any other ideas that maybe just didn't come to be in the end, didn't get developed?
Actually, no, this was the only
So is
idea
the only idea like amazing, now let's make it huge success.
Yeah, actually, when I bought the HTC Vive, I was in process of trying to figure out what to do next. So I spent almost 1 year just prototyping games, making a lot of prototypes, trying to figure out what will be the next step for the company. And I couldn't come up with anything really special. And then when I bought the HTC Vive and the idea came to my mind, I was like, okay. So sometimes you need just to switch the environment to come up with something different.
Right. So before we start talking about Beat Saber, is there any other sort of teams or development studios that you really sort of have a good friendship with, or any other VR games that really inspired you? I know you mentioned Audio Shield, but is there any other favorites that you've got that you love to play in VR yourself?
Yeah, sure. I played a lot of Thumper. It's not much
Oh
a
yeah,
VR
Thumper.
game.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, but I played it a lot, and also I like Super Hot. And all, yeah. Actually, I didn't play many VR games. I played most of them. I played on the PSVR. I played how you call that game with this something like Tetris, like in Super Hypercube.
Super Hypercube. I'm not quite sure.
Yeah, it's a complicated name, but
Right.
I played it a lot. I just
Okay.
don't remember the name. It was maybe 2 years ago.
Right, right.
And what was the question? Sorry, I
So
totally
just
forgot.
if there's any other game developments studios that
Yeah,
inspire you.
development studio. Actually, for VR development, not much, because I didn't play so many VR games, and I don't remember if there were any other like rhythm games back then. Than Audio Shield or Tamper when I started developing it. Later, more games came out, so they somehow influenced the development. Usually, we just try to figure out what doesn't work in their games, so we don't do the same mistakes. It's yeah. About the studios, I really like what Alchemy Labs are doing.
Oh, of course,
They're
yeah.
nice. Yeah.
Of course.
And also, I played a lot of Raw Data
Raw
in the
data,
beginning. Yeah, but I was too scared. I can't play games when big robots are trying to kill you from behind. It's not my style.
But it's funny that you say, you played a lot of Thumper and Audio Shield, and that you sort of have a bit of a music background yourself. So you're sort of into music, and those rhythm games kind of were the games that kind of almost inspired you to make Beat Saber, right?
Yeah, almost. I wouldn't say like directly, but for example, from Tamper, I really loved how aggressive the music is. All those like hits are really, really super strong. So I wanted to do something like that. So small influence is there too.
Absolutely, absolutely. Because they call it like a violent rhythm game, don't they, Thumper?
Yeah,
And it is. It's
they do.
very, very violent, that kind of beat. I totally agree. I totally agree. Okay, so let's talk about Beat Saber, because like Beat Saber right now is one of the highest rated games on Steam. Not just VR games, but all games. It's got 99% positive reviews. And that must just feel incredible to you and the team. Like, it's an amazing achievement. You must be super proud of the game.
Sure, we are super proud. We totally didn't expect that, especially if when we are going for early access, there's still like thousands of features missing in the game. There are a few bugs there. We need to fix them as soon as possible, and still people like the game, so it's amazing. It's amazing.
It is, it is. And I've got some more stats as well. So according to Steam DB, you have over 700 peak concurrent players daily. So like at its highest peak, 700 people are playing Beat Saber every day. And it's been like that since the launch. Like launch was over 1,000 concurrent players, but it's been like a steady sort of 700 each day since then. And that's pretty incredible because, I've seen previously when big VR titles launch like Skyrim or Fallout, they have great concurrent numbers in the first day, and then it really, really drops, like very rapidly drops. But for this, it's great for VR, and it's a great game that people are obviously keep coming back to, which is really, really good to know. And also, I've seen people say, I'm gonna go and buy a VR headset just so I can play Beat Saber, and that's incredible. Like, it's actually a headset seller. We've got this like killer app, I would say now, where you've got this amazing game, can't be played anywhere else other than VR right now. So you have to go out and buy a headset to go and experience this game.
Sure, you have to,
Yeah,
yeah.
so I
We keep hearing that all the time. Like, yeah, I should buy a headset for that. I actually would like to know how many people did buy something. I know about few, but like, if anyone did buy anything, just let me know. I would like to know.
We'd love to know. You can put them in the comments, and Jan can check out the comments later on. So yeah, like it would be interesting to see, like, after launch day, May 1st, if like sales like went up, you know, in terms of headset sales for Vive and Oculus. It would really be, well, that would be interesting. But I know that Oculus are very, very secretive about how many headsets they sell. So I don't know if we'll get that information. But yeah, let us know in the comments if you did buy a headset because of Beat Saber. So obviously we know that Beat Saber is hugely successful, but let's find out a bit more about how it got to be what it is today. So you mentioned about how the idea came about. You know, you wanted to create a rhythm game, and you just checked out the Vive. You've got like a kind of music background. So let's talk about your music background. So did you study music, or you've just had a passion for music your whole life?
Actually, I studied music just when I was maybe from age 6 to 15, so yeah. When I was young, but then I stopped. I actually didn't like it when I was younger.
Okay.
I played piano, but then I met some friends on a high school, so I started playing jazz and all that stuff.
Okay.
And when I moved to university to Prague, actually I went to Prague just because of jazz.
Oh, but wow.
Studying computer science. We just like, okay, yeah, I will study computer science, but let's play jazz.
Yeah,
because it's much more interesting. So actually, I spent the whole university just playing with bands.
Yeah,
playing concerts and all that stuff. And I wanted to be a music producer, but then I was like, okay, maybe not.
Well, you have almost done that in a roundabout sort of way, right?
Yeah, actually, I produced some artists and all this stuff, but I wasn't so I didn't think I was too good, or I was good enough, you know.
Okay.
It's I think that if you are trying to make something, it's great if you are able to be the best in the world, or at least going to like top 10%. And I know that for my playing skills and all this stuff, I am just like, I'm average. I'm not so good, you know.
So what's your instrument? Like, what do you play?
I played almost everything except brass stuff. So I play piano, drums, guitars, and all these things.
Yeah. So music really is in your blood, you know, which is obvious to see. Like, when you see a game like Beat Saber, you know, like the music is at the heart of it, right? So how long was Beat Saber in development? Like, how long ago was it that you actually started putting this game together?
I think we started maybe 1.5 years ago, or maybe almost 2 years ago.
Yeah.
We worked for... First, I started working alone, and then Lucky Man joined me, so we continued. And then in January last year, we stopped working on Beat Saber because we thought it's not good enough. So
Wow.
We just stopped. Yeah, we stopped working on it. We started to work on another game,
yeah,
on iOS, actually. But after 4 months, we showcased the Beat Saber on one small event in Prague. And a few people told us, wow, this is an amazing game. We should really continue and bring it to the market. So we did. So we continued to work on it.
Yeah.
So it was really interesting because, you know, usually I know if the game is good or not, mm-hmm. or at least I think I know, but this time I didn't know at all. I was like, okay, it's a VR game. You never know for VR games if people like the game,
yeah,
or if they like the VR.
Of course.
Yeah, this is super hard to tell because most of the people, when we show the game to them, it's their first VR experience.
Right. So they're amazed by VR anyway. So,
yeah,
right.
Definitely. So you have no idea if they like the game or they just like the VR. So,
okay. So how do you and Loki Man, how did you sort of coordinate the work over the year and a half or 2 years it's been in development? Do you sort of work together? Like, because you say you work from home, like, do you remote work? So he works from his home, you work from your home, you sort of meet up and coordinate? Or do you have like an office space that you use?
We both work from home. We have daily calls in the morning.
Yeah.
So at 9 a.m. we just call and talk about what to do next. I'm mainly responsible for the design, graphic stuff, and all the gameplay programming.
Mm-hmm.
And he's doing all these tools for that, and combining scenes, all these like things around that, sometimes some effects and all that stuff. So
yeah,
basically we are quite well separated, and we can work together easily.
And how did you end up meeting Yaroslav? How did you end up sort of working with him, because he composes all the music, right?
Yeah, he's actually from Czech Republic too.
Okay.
So, but he lives in LA now.
Nice.
yeah, and he was actually our only choice. I when I was thinking like what to do next with the Beat Saber, I wanted to bring it to the next level, because in the beginning I made all the music, and I wanted to make all the soundtrack. But then idea came to my mind, let's try to put it to the next level and let's talk to Yaroslav. We knew each other from some conferences and some events, but we actually never spoke together for more than like 1 minute or something like that.
Right.
So we just knew we existed, but we were not friends at all or nothing like that.
Yeah.
But then we released the trailer, the first trailer for Beat Saber. I put it on a Facebook group of local developers.
Yeah.
And he checked it there, and he called me like, "Okay, I should make a music for you for this game. It would be awesome." And he actually called me the day before I wanted to call him.
So oh, right, nice.
Really interesting. So nice. We met in Prague, and he just proposed us some like how we can do that together, and so he joined the team and made all the soundtrack.
Amazing. So did any of the original tracks that you made, did they ever make it into the game, or is it all his music?
No.
Okay.
It's all his music. Okay. Actually, I want to make something, but he said like, okay, you can do it for yourself.
Well, now you've got...
No.
Yeah. Right. No, all the tracks came from him.
Yeah, all the tracks came from him. And right. But maybe in the future, one track will be from me.
Okay,
I hope
cool. Yeah. Like a little bonus track, like, you know.
Yeah,
or some DLC
like
or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
So obviously May 1st was the launch day for the game. So, you know, when you've been making something for so long and you've invested all this time and effort into it, and you know you've got something potentially the magical on your hands, how was the launch day for you? Because I understand that some of the team were like flying out somewhere, so you were on your own, is that right?
Yeah, it was super crazy because Lucky Man was on flight to Sydney,
right?
So he didn't have any internet access, and he was actually responsible for doing all the Steam and Oculus administration stuff. So he just gave me some notes like, okay, here is the Steam page, it looks like this, you just press this release button at 6 p.m
Wow.
So yeah, I pressed it, and something happened. And the game was still not out. So people start messaging me on Twitter like, what's happening? It should be out at 6 p.m. and it's not out yet.
Oh.
So I was really, really like trying to figure that out. And there was another button like release from early access. So I pressed that again. So I actually, I released the game out of early access. So it was in early access for like 1 minute maybe. And that's quite a big problem because you don't want to sell the game like a full release, you know?
Of course.
Fortunately, the guys from Steam were really fast, so they fixed it like almost instantly.
Okay.
Which you can't do. You can't go back from full release to early access, you know?
That's, right, that's Steam have to help you. Right.
Yes, they have to help me. So they were really, really helpful, and so they fixed it. But it was a lot of stress, you know.
Of course. Yeah, I can imagine. Especially if that's not what you normally do day to day, and someone else is in charge of it, and you're giving the controls over on such an important day. It must have been very stressful for you. But after it was out, like that day, were you just kind of like watching people's reviews come up or watching people's like reactions to it? Or did you just kind of like walk away from it and have a break, or you just couldn't stay away?
I walked away from it. Yeah. I just needed to have a break. Like we have a small meeting with Yaroslav because he went to Prague a few days before that. Or maybe just day before that, he flew from LA to Prague. So we just met in the bar and just celebrate a little bit.
Yeah.
I started watching reviews more days after that.
Right.
Actually, I don't like watching reviews. I feel like, okay, I don't like to watch it. I like to read about bugs and bad things which are in the game, so I know that I can fix it.
Right.
So I do that a lot.
So for you, the feedback that you really want is like little bugs that people find and the problems that they've had with the game, rather than this great praise of like the game is wonderful. That's more important.
I didn't want to say that.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, of course I like when people
yeah,
like
of course.
It.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel incredible, but I'm also afraid that something will go wrong. And,
right,
you know,
of course.
Like they like it and then something like the game crashes or something like that,
Yeah.
which happened too.
Right.
For mixed reality stuff, because
Right, right.
there was small bug in the Leaf SDK, but fortunately we fixed that, so it should be okay now.
So that's an interesting point actually you just made there about Live and the mixed reality stuff, because I once saw a tweet of yours and it said that you spent zero on marketing. Is that actually true? Like you didn't spend much on marketing?
Yeah, actually, no money yet.
Yeah,
we have a girl which is helping us with marketing, but she offered to do that for free. But eventually, we have to pay her.
Yeah,
of course. But from day zero, we didn't spend like nothing on marketing.
Yeah,
nothing, zero.
And that's incredible, because there was so much hype about the game prior to the release, right? And you mentioned Liv as well, and I think that's a lot to do with the relationship you must have had with them as a team.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know, for those that are watching that don't know what Liv is, it's essentially a mixed reality tool that you can download for free on Steam. And mixed reality compatible games, you can create this amazing mixed reality view of it. And they created some videos on YouTube of them playing the game in mixed reality view. And those videos just went viral, right? And that built a lot of hype around the game. People were very excited about it because the videos were so visceral. You know, they looked amazing. They were very vibrant in color. The music itself was fantastic as well. And all those things combined just made for this amazing mix of something that looked incredible to watch. So how did that relationship with the Liv team come about? I'd be interested to know, because you were developing a mixed reality tool yourself to implement in the game, right?
Yeah. When we started showcasing the game, we immediately realized we need to have some kind of mixed reality setup.
Mm-hmm.
So we created our own stuff. But later on, one of my friends from Prague started to work for Liv.
Right.
So, and he told me, okay, they are making this mixed reality system, which you can include in your game and it will work just fine.
Mm-hmm.
So I told him, like, okay, let's put it there by yourself. Let's see if it works. So I gave him the source code of Beat Saber. He put the SDK into the game and it worked. So this was the first step. Then we started to talk to Liv guys, like, okay, you can show the game to some people. They were the only one in the world who can do that.
Yeah, of course.
So our relationship was just based on the friendship with my friends in Prague. Actually.
Yeah. And it's amazing because Liv has helped promote Beat Saber and Beat Saber has helped promote Liv. Like,
sure.
It's almost like the perfect relationship, right? You know, they
both
worked so well together. And those videos were so great. But it's amazing as well that you had the foresight as a developer to say, what is the best way that I can portray this feeling of being in VR and playing this game? Because mixed reality is one of those things that, you know, is a bit niche. Some people create mixed reality content, some people don't. But when you get it right, it looks so amazing. And Audio Shield as well was one of those games that implemented it really well from the beginning.
Yeah.
So you knew that from the outset that you wanted something that looked great in mixed reality as well.
Yeah, sure. Because without mixed reality, you can figure out how the game feels, but if you see it in mixed reality, you really know how it's like, all the environment around you, how big the things are.
Yeah. You get that's the thing, like I always say about VR, like it's one of those things that you really need to try it for yourself to sort of really understand it. And even for me as a content creator on YouTube, you know, doing YouTube video let's plays of games is very difficult to portray what it's actually like to be in VR. But mixed reality, especially with like games like Beat Saber, someone can watch it and have no idea what mixed reality is and instantly understand what's happening there, you know, like that. Oh, that person is in the game. They're in the game and they're experiencing it for themselves. Like that's the amazing thing about mixed reality. And I really hope more developers, you know, really sort of understand that and try and implement something like that in their game for future VR games. Definitely.
Yeah, it's actually not so hard if you are using the Leaf plugin. It's almost super easy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you just need to have a strong enough computer to run it.
Yeah, exactly. Because I understand you went out to, was it GDC with the Live team? Was it GDC that you went out to?
Yeah, I was at GDC. Yeah, they did few showcases there.
Yeah, because they had their, they've got Live cubes now, which are these like green screen cubes that you can just buy. It's got lights integrated with it. So all you need is a camera and the game and a PC, and you're pretty much set up for mixed reality. But yeah, I remember a lot of my friends, like Caleb from Reality Check VR, he was checking out the game, and I was like sitting at home like, I just want to play the game so badly. So like, I had to wait. But you know, it's finally here and I get to play it as much as I want, so that's really, really cool. So people are making tons of content on YouTube, and people are playing this game on Twitch as well. Lots of people are creating content around Beat Saber, some using mixed reality, some not. But other people are being creative in other ways, and you've probably seen this as well. Like, you've got like people making Darth Maul style lightsabers, so the lightsabers are fixed to a pipe and they're doing it that way.
Yeah.
And then there was someone recently I saw that had like nunchucks, so they'd put it on a piece of string and they were like swinging it around. And then finally, the weirdest one I've seen so far is some guy actually slipped the touch controllers over his feet and was playing with his
feet.
Wow.
I haven't seen that.
You haven't seen that? Yeah, so there is a video on YouTube of a guy playing Beat Saber with his feet, so you can check that out. But like, have you seen any other creative ways that people have played the game, or any other sort of bits and pieces that you thought, oh, that was kind of cool? You know,
I've saw most of what you were talking about.
Yeah.
But mainly what surprised me is the community, which is creating mods for the game.
Right.
I mean, like changing colors, importing. They made editors for the game. Actually, I think there are already three editors out there where you can make your own levels.
Wow. And are these available like from Steam Workshop or something like that?
No.
Oh, okay. Oh, right. So they're just like a downloadable from a website or something like that. You have to go and hunt them out.
Something like that, yeah.
Right, okay.
It's not officially supported by us, but like,
sure.
Okay, let's make them do it.
Sure.
But our editor should be out tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But it will be just alpha. It might be worse than what they did.
Talking about the level editor, because I've seen videos on YouTube of people already like experimenting with it, and I've seen like them integrating their own music. And this was something that you said earlier on about Audio Shield. You didn't like the way necessarily that it procedurally generated a track for you. You wanted sort of total control over it. And that's exactly what the track editor does, right? So you can import a song, and then you place the cubes manually yourself to create a track.
Definitely, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's what we would like to do in the future. We would like to integrate some of the streaming services.
Yeah.
To allow you to make any song, any level for any music. But this is the future. Right now, we will be just releasing alpha of the editor. So yeah. If you have your own music, you can make a level, play it, maybe send it to someone else who has the MP3 or the music file. It would be good if it's bought like legally. Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
So no shady business. And
And that's the thing, like, creating content as well around these sort of custom tracks, you know, especially on YouTube, you can get like content flags, you know, copyright flags for music specifically. YouTube is really hot on it, and same with Twitch as well. And I like the way that as a team, you straight away from the beginning said, you know, we're going to stop these copyright claims so people can create content of our game and not have to worry about getting like claimed for copyright.
Yes,
and then
yes.
Their videos get demonetized. So that was a real bonus for us as content creators as well. So we thank you for that. But is that something you consciously sort of thought about, or was it something that just kind of cropped up during the development?
Yeah, actually, Yaroslav, we thought about when we started showing it to some people for the content creators, and I realized that there will be a problem because I put the song on my channel.
Of course, yeah.
And I received the claim for the copyright.
Right.
So I'm like, okay, we have to figure this out, because if all the YouTube content creators will receive this claim, they won't be able to monetize their videos. They won't make any videos of our game,
yeah.
Which is not good. So let's figure out how to do that. So we just remove the content ID for all the songs. Except one is quite problematic, but because
it's
we live before.
Country Roads, is that the one?
That's one. But we are trying to do that too, so it just takes more time.
Yeah, sure.
All our tracks should be good. Maybe I don't know all the details because Yaroslav is in charge of all the music things decisions.
Yeah.
But I think we will try to keep this also for the future songs we will add into the game.
Oh right, yeah, definitely. Yeah, that'd be really useful. So you say just going quickly back to the level editor. So if I create a level around a track, as long as like my friend has got the same track, I can send him the file to play that himself, but yes, I can't share it with everyone yet. Or can I do? Is there? There's no way, an easy way to share user created tracks right now.
Maybe I shouldn't talk about it, but there is a website where people are sharing some tracks already.
You don't have to share it if you don't want to. If it's something shady, then don't worry.
Yeah, we didn't make it, but some people did already.
Okay, you know, so if you're interested, you can go and search for it, but we won't necessarily promote it. But that's cool. So, like, in terms of, let's talk about like the future of Beat Saber and the team as well. Obviously, on the same day that Beat Saber launched, the Oculus Go launched. So it was like for me, it was such a crazy week for VR. Like everything just was kind of going crazy. Loads of people were talking about VR industry, Beat Saber, you know, Oculus Go. It was a great week for VR in general. So I don't know if you've had chance to get your hands on the Oculus Go or if you've actually tried it yourself yet.
Actually, no, I didn't.
You haven't
try
tried it. Okay. So, whilst we're on the subject of Oculus Go, would you be tempted to make a port of Beat Saber on the Go, or is it something that's completely like not on the table right now? You're focused on other things first, or
correct me if I'm wrong, but Oculus Go doesn't have six depth of field controllers.
That's correct. So you've got a 3DOF headset and a 3DOF controller. But I understand the limitations because, of course, you want that kind of movement and you're restricted to just this.
Yeah,
but like when I think about a game that I'd love to play on the go, Beat Saber is definitely one of them. And I understand the limitations of the hardware, but even having a single stick like this where I could just swipe in any direction and then like maybe because you've only got one controller, obviously, with the Go, you could press the trigger and that would change it from blue to red, and then you could do the red one and the blue one. And you'd have to have another layer of skill to play the Go version, I think, over the full version.
Definitely, it will be a different game. So it's not on our roadmap right now.
Yeah.
Because there's still a few more platforms which have all these controllers.
Okay.
We should support. So first we will do all that stuff, and then we will move to different platforms.
So would that other platform maybe be the PSVR?
I can't talk about it.
Okay. So let's talk about any other sort of additions that you'd love to add in the roadmap to Beat Saber. So what sort of things have you got planned? Obviously, the track editor you're working on right now is just about to be released tomorrow, you say, for public. Mm-hmm. What other sort of things have you got in your roadmap? Obviously, like more tracks.
There are a few like segments we would like to work on. Mm-hmm. First is actually the songs or content, more levels and all the stuff. So we would like to work with more musicians, more producers to bring original content to the game.
Yeah.
Then of course maybe we will license some music.
Yeah.
But I'm not 100% sure if we want to do that, but it's one of the options. Mm-hmm. Then we would like to add a lot of new features, like right now we are measuring a lot of stuff in the Beat Saber, like how hard are you moving, how far you move the sabers and all the small stuff. So mm-hmm. we can make a lot of statistics when you finish the level and show you how you're improving your skills and all that stuff.
Right.
And also we would maybe like to make a single player campaign or something like that.
Okay.
Which would be some kind of progress. So you just don't play levels one by one as you want.
But you have to unlock them.
Yeah, you have to unlock them. You have to complete some challenges. And this will be really interesting because we think there's a lot of ways how to play the Beat Saber. You don't necessarily have to play just for the score.
Yeah.
You can play just like with tiny movements. You can make huge cuts. You can move a lot around the place. You can just stay at one place. And there's a lot of things we have in our mind. And then also the multiplayer will be very interesting.
Multiplayer. See, like, this is... So, you know, like, multiplayer is exciting to me because... So I play Box VR as well before I played Beat Saber, and, you know, it's a beat game, you know, that's kind of thing. They implemented a multiplayer, but the problem with the multiplayer in Box VR was that you couldn't see each other. So it was just based on your score, right? So you could see the other person's score going up, but actually seeing someone else is very important. So I don't know if that's what you're working on, but that's what I would say.
Yeah, that's one of our visions. We didn't start to work on that, but of course we want you to see the other player playing against you, so you feel how it is. But we actually have one more really interesting idea to make a competitive multiplayer where you are not playing the same song and the same level, but you are playing against each other.
Right.
And you are basically creating the song for your opponent, which will be super interesting.
Right. So what about, like, because I remember in like Guitar Hero, you had cooperative tracks. So mm-hmm. one person can play part of the song, then the next person plays part of the song, and then you sort of take it in turns. Is that something you've kind of thought about as well?
Actually, not. Okay. Not this one.
Okay.
Yeah, we just have this, like, simple. Actually, we didn't think about multiplayer too much because it's in the future. I think if we start working on the multiplayer, it'll be like in 2 months,
not much sooner. Okay. So before we move on, is there any tips that you could give to people to, you know, rank up those leaderboards? Because, like, one of the things I noticed, even, like, when I was playing Beat Saber prior to release, I was very fortunate to get hold of it before the release, there was a real competitive feeling amongst the players that were playing. Like, they were like, right, I'm going to beat that guy. And people were really scrambling to get to the top of the leaderboards. And I think I made it there briefly. And then as soon as the game came out, I was like, see ya. You know, like, there's nowhere nowhere near the top 100 now. So if you've got any tips for people to get a high score, like, what is it? Is it the angle of the cut? Is it, like, the center of the cube? Like, if you could explain that would be great.
I actually made a video explaining that.
I'm not sure.
You haven't seen it, right?
I think I saw it briefly on your Twitter, right? So it's all about angle. Is that right?
It's about the swing angle, so it doesn't matter if the cube is you are trying to cut it from the top. It doesn't mean you have to be straight line like this. You can even cut it like in 45 degrees. It's kind of okay. It's not a big deal. Even you can have the 100 per the cube, even if you cut like this, and it should be from the top. Right. So this angle is not important, but you have to, like, really go from 90 degrees to the zero, and then you should continue down. So, like, let's make a huge cuts, not just like these small things, but, like, really, really go through the cube.
And I think, was it 20 or 30 degrees after the middle of the cube?
I think it was 60.
Oh, maybe. Right. Wow. So you really have to go straight through it and, like, have that really big hand movement.
Yeah. Actually, it's super easy to do that when you are cutting from the top to the bottom.
Right.
But when you are doing the opposite direction, it's super hard.
Yes. You're right.
That's why most of the people are like, okay, I can do this like 100, but when I'm going from down, I can barely 60, 70. Yeah, that's one of the challenges.
Yeah.
No one is super. I think some of those expert levels are so hard, it's not even possible to play them for like 100% score.
Right. Yeah, because, like, we've seen people, like, really go to town, like, playing it hardcore so they can get the highest score on the leaderboards. And it's funny because when I was trying to learn how to play it, like, I can just about play some tracks on expert. Like, I mostly play it on hard. Like, hard, I can pretty much do all the tracks. That's fine. And I was chatting to Rue, who is from the Live team, and he plays Box VR every morning on his Twitch channel. And I was like, Rue, he's, like, really good at beat games, like, so good. And he can play everything on expert, like, he's crazy. And I was like, dude, like, how do I get a good score on this? And he was just don't think about the cubes. Just listen to the music, because everything is obviously in time with the music perfectly. So he goes, forget about the cubes. There are no cubes. It's a bit like The Matrix. There is no spoon. And just focus on the music and you'll be fine. I was like, oh, okay. So I did actually improve after that. So I'm getting better. But I can't quite do a really... I can't get a good score on the leaderboards in expert yet. But I'll keep trying. Yeah, but, I'll keep trying.
Yeah, but you know, there are some people which already told me the game is too easy. You should make it much harder.
Oh, really?
You know, yeah, it happens all the time. I know those people will always show up. So
yeah,
we are working on expert plus.
Wow. Because I remember playing Guitar Hero back in the day, and the jump from medium to hard was like that big jump. And it's the same I felt with like hard to expert. Like it was kind of easy to learn gradually and go up to hard, but that jump from hard to expert is a big jump I felt. But it really gives you that, if you invest the time in learning the tracks, then you will be good at the game, right?
Sure.
And that's the thing, like the soundtrack, you can buy the soundtrack separately. It's available like on iTunes, and you can buy the track, listen to it in your free time, just dream of those cubes coming down towards you, and then you can be good at the game eventually.
Definitely.
So before we wrap up the interview, is there anything else in the roadmap that you want to sort of talk about? You've teased at like multiplayer, you've teased at like expert plus mode, and some sort of the track editor is obviously coming out tomorrow. Is there anything else that you want to share? Like, you know, I know that you've got a history of iOS development. You know, is there any port of this maybe coming to mobile? Because I remember seeing somewhere, I can't remember where I saw it, but there was a video somewhere of someone playing Beat Saber on a phone. Is that right?
Yeah, one of my friends did that on April 1st, so he just got some kind of joke, so he just took the video and moved his fingers on the screen, but it looks really cool.
It did look really cool, so
yeah.
No ideas for that right now?
I wouldn't say ideas, you know, it's just three guys right now, or maybe we are four. It's four guys right now in the team, so even if we want to make all that stuff, it would take like a lot of time.
Of course.
So, definitely we would like to put it on mobile, and we would like to put it on Nintendo Switch, of course.
We
need some much more time for that. So let's right now we will focus on just the VR headset we have and add more, and then when we have everything perfect, we will go to other platforms.
Brilliant. So I take it, in terms of your studio right now, you've got no other games that you've kind of got on the horizon. Beat Saber is going to be your sole focus right now.
Yeah, definitely. I think the plan was to stay with Beat Saber at least for 1 year from now, like the minimum. But maybe we will spend more years with just a Beat Saber if it works out, you know.
Yeah. Well, I'm really excited to see what happens next with Beat Saber. You know, I'm loving the game. Everyone's enjoying the game. I think you've done a fantastic job on it. So congratulations. Is there anything else you want to add before we wrap the interview up?
Yeah, sure. I would like to remind you that don't destroy your arms playing the game, because it can be really, sometimes we wanted to put some warning there that, like, but obviously HTC Vive and also Oculus have their warnings all the time.
Yeah.
But please be very careful, because if you play a lot, you can really harm yourself.
So that's one of the things. Like, I played the game a lot, and I was getting really hot. Like, it's a great workout. Like, if you want a real great workout, it's a great one in VR. But like you say, my arms, the next day I was like, oh, I feel so sore. And then but I was desperate to get on the leaderboard, so I was like, just push through the pain, like, just play more.
I know how it feels, because when I'm creating those levels, I have to play them all the time. So, you know, I'm playing the expert level for 50 times in a row.
Wow.
So I'm like, oh, damn, I can't do it anymore. So it's really crazy.
Yeah. So there you go. Have a little warning about your arms. Just be sensible with it is the answer. So so we'll wrap this one up. But yeah, I just want to thank you again for being part of the interview. I really appreciate you taking time out to talk to me. Congratulations again on Beat Saber being a huge success. And best of luck in the future. I can't wait to see what Beat Saber comes out with next. Really excited.
Thank you. It was my pleasure having I'm too tired. You know, I'm just working on all these levels and all this stuff all day.
Of course. So there we have it, guys and girls. I really hope you've enjoyed this interview with Jan. Let me know in the comments down below if you want to see more developer interviews like this. We had a great fun sort of just chatting today. Leave a like if you like the video. Make sure you're subscribed for all my future content. And as always, I'll see you on the next one. Cheers.
Bye.